سبيلي أدعو إلى الله على بصيرة أنا ومن اتبعني وسبحان الله وما أنا من المشركين.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. Welcome brothers and sisters. Today inshallah we are going to complete our topic about the misconceptions or about the allegations about collecting the Quran, about how the Quran have been collected. But before we start, please, brothers and sisters, may you pray for one of our brothers who died recently. He was a very, very good brother. He was so closer to me, and he died suddenly by cancer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him and let him to enter to the paradise without any torment. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Allahumma ameen ya rabbal alameen. Last class we were talking about the compilation of the Quran, and we said that some of the closest companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam devoted themselves to learning the text of the Quran by heart. This included some of the companions, some of Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like Ubay ibn Ka'b, like Mu'adh ibn Jabal, like Zayd ibn Thabit, Abu Darda radiallahu anhum. And we said that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu himself collected more than 90 of the 114 chapters by himself from the Quran, learning the remaining chapters from other companions. And we have mentioned that Imam As-Suyuti rahimahullah stated that the Quran ascended down from Allah in separate stages, had been completely written down and carefully preserved, but that it had not been assembled into one single location during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And after the death the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Umar radiallahu anhu decided to compile the Quran, in a book form. He gave a sermon asking the people to bring him any papers, wood plates, leaf stalks of date palms on which they might have written any verses of the Quran after listening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Umar radiallahu anhu did not accept anything from anyone unless he obtained confirmation of two witnesses for everything brought to him. Meantime, Umar radiallahu anhu was martyred. Then Uthman radiallahu anhu followed the same principle of accepting from people verses of the Quran only with confirmation from two witnesses. For any part of Uthman, the differences in reading the Quran became so obvious that after consultation with the companions, Uthman radiallahu anhu had a standard copy prepared from the Suhuf of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, which was kept with Hafsa, and he ordered all other copies destroyed. This is the short story of collecting the Quran during the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ and after the Prophet ﷺ. But we have here a misconception, we have here an allegation, which is some Christian missionaries using a report from Sunan Ibn Majah. And this is the question. They are asking us that they read a tradition or hadith by Aisha radiallahu anha that some verses of the Quran were lost as they were eaten by a goat. So let us answer this misconception. Let us declare this hadith and analyze the narration and try to find out what is the truth. the narration goes as reported Aisha radiallahu anha, the verse of stoning and of suckling an adult 10 times was revealed, and they were written on a paper and kept under my pillow. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam expired, we were occupied by his death. A goat entered and ate away the paper. This hadith had been mentioned in Sunan Ibn Majah, hadith number 1944. Well, let us discuss the authenticity of the narration. Whenever we have a narration, we ought to see whether it is authentic or not. The narration, in fact, has some problems. Why is that? The particular chain given in Sunan Ibn Majah about this hadith, about this tradition, finds one of the narrators, Muhammad Ibn Ishaq. One of the narrators of this hadith is Muhammad Ibn Ishaq. He is narrating it using the word an. Do you know what's the meaning of an? When I say it is a narration an, about or from. Okay? Which is rather an ambiguous way of narration and renders the narration weak when used by a narrator known for practicing tadlis. Tadlis, it is lying. Practice of subtly missing a link, okay? Subtly missing a link. This is the meaning of tadlis, is lying. And Muhammad ibn Ishaq is indeed such a narrator. He is a liar in that. Thus, through particular chain of narration in Sunan ibn Majah, the narration is weak, so this hadith, which is talking about a goat which ate parts of the Quran, this hadith is weak. It's not true and authentic due to above mentioned defect, though it has other issues as well as mentioned in the line to follow. In Musnad Ahmad, the same narration is given through the same chain, but with an explicit way of narration. It was not have the defect like the narration of Ibn Majah collection, but the narration is exposed to more criticism because many other narrators have related from Aisha. Many other narrators have related from Aisha radiallahu anha about the suckling, but no one has narrated the words found in the chain, even though the narrators in these cases are more reliable and consistent than Muhammad ibn Ishaq. And due to the fact of these words being narrated solely, just only by him, and in defiance to other much more reliable narrators, scholars have questioned its authenticity. The narration no way questions Quran infallibility. He's trying to question the infallibility of Quran. Even if the narration were authentic, it no way questions the claim of Quran being totally preserved. And where are some evidences we have here some evidences of for this. Evidence number one. One of the two allegedly lost verses, as per this narration, was about stoning, a punishment of married adulterers. But other narrations prove that commandment was revealed about stoning, but the Holy Prophet ﷺ did not allowed it to be written as a part of the Quran, implying that it was not meant to be Quran integral part. We will follow one of the narrations that testifies this meaning. It is reported in a narration from Kathir ibn Salt that Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu said, I hear the Messenger of Allah says, when a married man or woman commit adultery, stone them both to death. Hearing this, Amr, and he said, when this verse revealed, I came to the Prophet ﷺ and I asked it if I could write it. He disliked it. The Prophet ﷺ disliked it. So, about this verse, Kathir ibn Salt says that he, Zayd ibn Thabit and Marwan ibn Hakam were discussing as to why it's not written in the Quranic manuscript, and Umar ibn Khattab was present with them and listening to their discussion. He said he knew it better than them and told them that he came to the Messenger of Allah, said, O Messenger of Allah, let the verse about stoning be written for me. But the Prophet said, I cannot do this. I cannot do this. Had it meant to be a part of the Quran, why would Holy Prophet ﷺ dislike its being written? And who could stop him from doing that? Moreover, Aisha radiallahu anha lived through the whole period of the Quran compilation during the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Uthman radiallahu anhu, while she was unanimously considered an authority for herself. So if she had any thought about some verses missing, she would have brought it to attention of other companions of the Prophet ﷺ. In fact, we have here evidence of Uthman radiallahu anhu making special endeavor of consulting Aisha radiallahu anha and her records for verifying the official compilation. Despite all this, she never raised the issue supporting our conclusion that no part of the Quran was lost, even if the narration is considered true. Okay? So this is our answer about the first misconception about the goat which ate some of the parts of the Quran. So this narration is weak. It is hadithun da'if. Another question here, what is the differences in the way of reciting the Quran? Why we have here seven recitation recitations. We will answer this why we have here seven recitation of the Quran. We have seven dialects, seven different dialects of the Quran. And what's the reason for this differences? The reason for this, that the Quran was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ in seven different dialects, as it is narrated through many sound chains. It is narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim from Ibn Abbas that the Prophet said, Jibril has recited the Quran to me in one way. Then I requested him to read it in another way, and continued asking him to recite it in another way, and he recited it in several ways till he ultimately recited it in seven different ways. Imam Muslim narrated from Ibn Shihab that he said those seven different dialects are in recitation only, and they do not have any effect on the meaning. It's like there's no defect, there's no effects on the, for example, halal or haram. The Prophet said the Quran has been revealed in seven different ways, so recite it in the way that is easier for you. It is a fact that the differences in the ways of recitation of the Quran is a difference of varieties, not a contradiction between the various dialects. Any contradiction between the words of Allah, any contradiction in the Quran is impossible. Any contradiction in the Quran is impossible. Allah says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Do they not then consider the Quran carefully? Had it been from other than God, other than Allah, they would surely have found therein much contradictions. Imam Ibn al-Jazari said, we consider the recital way of the Quran we find according to three conditions. We have here three conditions of the differences between the seven dialects. The first condition, the difference of words but the meaning is the same meaning, such as the word alayhim and the word alayhum. We can read it alayhim according to one recitation, and we can say it, we can recite it alayhum. And al-Quds wal-Qudus, the same word in the same position. We can read it al-Quds or al-Qudus according to the dialect that we are using to read, to recite. And we have the word yahsubu or yahsibu. Okay? So the first condition, as we mentioned, the differences of words but the meaning is the same meaning. Okay? The second condition is the difference in both, in words as well as the meaning, but it's the last, they indicate only one subject. For example, the word Malik and Malik. We are reading it in the Quran in Surah Al-Fatiha, Maliki Yawm al-Din, and we can in another dialect we can say Maliki Yawm al-Din. So both are true. Malik means the Malik means the king, but Malik is the Lord, the owner of the Day of Judgment. Maliki Yawm al-Din. We can see that in the Surah Al-Fatiha, chapter Al-Fatiha, verse number 3. Both words, though they are different in pronunciation, Maliki and Malik, they are different in pronunciation and meaning. They indicate only one thing, Because the king is the owner, is the Lord. So both are true. When I say Allah is the king, it is true. And when I say Allah is the Lord, it is true. Here they mean Allah the alone. Another example is from chapter 2, verse 259, which is the word nunshizuha. Nunshizuha, which means we bring them together till they become complete. And the same word, we can pronounce it in another way by saying nunshiruha. Nunshiruha. We animate it or animate them. Okay? This Allah put two meanings in two different ways of recitation. The third condition is the difference in both, in the words and the meaning. So they indicate various objects. There is no contradiction between them. For example, see the verse number 110 in chapter 12. وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ قَدْ كُذِّبُوا. The word كُذِّبُوا, which means the messengers believe that their people have accused them of lying. In another way of recitation, وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ كُذِبُوا, not as like the first كُذِبُوا, it is كُذِبُوا, كُذِبُوا, which means the messengers come to think that they were treated as liars. Okay, is it clear? Is it clear, brothers and sisters? Is it clear? It becomes clear from the above details that there is no real contradiction in meaning among the ways of recitation. The difference appears superficially only. There is no difference in the essential matters. As for the benefits of the differences among the ways of recitation, they are numerous among them, like, for example, to make the recitation of the Quran easy and convenient for Ummah. To make the recitation of Quran easy and convenient for the nation. To prove the miracle of the Quran with complete abridgment. To prove with clear signs that Quran is revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because despite the mentioned differences, they support each other in a harmony and attractive style. This coordination proves that the Quran is a miracle, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and all his teachings are true. Allah says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Do they not then consider the Quran carefully? Had it been from other than Allah, they would surely have found therein much contradictions. It is clear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed the protection of His words for Himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved the protection of His words for Himself. This is yet another sign of the authenticity of the Quran that makes knowledge of His religion in all places and times through authentic scholars and others who memorize the Quran, its words, know its different recital ways, clarify its explanation, meanings and differentiate between the correct and the authentic narrations and those which are incorrect and weak. They point out the more appropriate recitation of the Uthmani Mus'haf from those which are not so. If we answer the misconception about the different dialects about the Quran, we have to ask Christians, those who are asking us about the different recitation of the Quran, we shall ask them also how many books of the Bible are truly inspired. This question is directly to the Christian. This question is directly to the Christians, because today Christian sects are not agreed on the definition of what exactly is an inspired book of God. The Protestants are taught that there are 66 truly inspired books in the Bible, while the Catholic have been taught that there are 73 truly inspired books. So which one is the Word of God? If you are judging us or asking about us about the seven dialects about the Quran, we are asking you about the different number of chapters and books in the Holy Bible. Which one is the Word of God? We are waiting for your answer. Anytime, inshallah, our room is opening for 24 hours, 7 days a week, 30 days in the month. We are waiting for your answer, inshallah. And this is the end of our class. I hope it was useful for you, inshallah.